Hello, everybody. Everybody, how you doing? Ambassador Larry Huggins here in Barcelona, Spain. Mrs. Huggins is off camera, but she'll be helping Marsha Murphy moderate. So thank you, Marsha, for being the faithful moderator and friend that you've been. And thank you, Mrs. Huggins. Do you want to say anything?
Hello and welcome to everyone.
Yeah, listen, if we're having any problems, let us know in the comments. We're trying a new program, and every time we do that, we can go through the dry runs. It works fine, and then we go live. Sometimes things happen, especially audio. I want to make sure that you're getting an audio feed, so if there's no audio, let me know right now. Can you hear me? Of course, if you can't hear me, you don't know what I'm saying anyway. So anyway, let us know. We're going to pray. We're going to have a great program today. We've been talking about winds of change. Back in December, I had a word from the Holy Spirit that forecast winds of change for 2019. And I'll give you a personal testimony. My wife and I are experiencing some very good changes, very positive changes. So what we prophesied is affecting us, and I have talked to some of my friends, and I see them going through changes as well. And I believe the Holy Spirit has given us a heads up on this to be prepared. There's an old saying that to be forewarned is to be forearmed. In other words, if we know something's happened, we can make the mental adjustments and position ourselves for success. Change is not necessarily bad. I know that some people resist change, but we know this, and it's going to happen anyway. It's inevitable. One thing that stays the same about life is change. Change is the one thing that always stays the same. So in addition to talking about the winds of change today and praying for everyone, we are going to have communion as well. And I'm going to, right before I pray, pop a little screen up here so that you can see something here. Let me see. Here we go. Take a look at this. We have set ourselves a goal of 33 new partners right away, immediately. 33 new partners. We would like to have our friends agree with us for 33 new partners. We've done some calculations, and this will help us reach one of our milestones. Very important. If you're not a partner, please pray about it. During this program, you can become a partner at any time. There will be a link in the comments section. You can hit the link, pop over, sign up. It'll take about 2 minutes. It's very simple. And pop back. For the price of a cup of coffee, you can become an entry-level partner with us, $1 a day. And coffee, I tell you what, if you go to a very popular coffee shop that has the initials SB, Starbucks, I went ahead and said it, it's going to cost you $1.85 for the smallest coffee they have, just a regular brew. If you get into fancy coffees, it goes all the way up to over $5. So for less than a cup of coffee, you can be a partner. I don't see why anyone would not want to be a partner. So pray about that. And now let's go back and let's have a word of prayer before we begin. And yes, I'm going to reiterate, we will have live online communion. So make sure you have the elements ready, a little bit of juice, a little bit of bread, whatever you have. I'm sure the Lord will accept it. We're going to pray over it, sanctify it. So Father, I thank you in Jesus' name for everyone who's participating in this broadcast, both live and those who are seeing it recorded. And we thank you for your blessing upon everybody, upon the word, upon the hearers. And I pray that the Holy Spirit will just really make this real in the hearts of everyone so that we can be prepared for the winds of change that are beginning to blow. We'll be able to hoist our sails and capture the wind, and you're going to take us where we need to go. In Jesus' name, we will be positioned and we'll be ready for the changes that are coming in this world. In Jesus' name, amen. Praise God. Amen. Well, let me read a scripture to you, and this will be our text for today, Ephesians 2:6. It's a beautiful in him scripture. You know me, I'm an in him person. I study Pauline revelation. Every other word that comes out of my mouth is something about who we are in Christ, what we have in Christ and what we can do through our divine union with Christ. It is the essence of the New Testament, the message of grace, talking about how we came into relationship with the Heavenly Father through Jesus Christ, because we are in Jesus and He's in relationship with the Father. Therefore, we are in relationship with the Father. Amen?
Amen.
And in the Ephesians 2:6, we're going to pop that up on the screen for you. Ephesians 2:6, He hath raised us up together and made us to sit in the heavenly places in Christ. In Christ. In is the preposition that shows relationship. Christ. What has happened in Christ? We have been raised up together and made to sit in the heavenlies at the right hand of the Father. Jesus was raised up in the heavenlies. And when He was raised up, you and I were raised up because we're in Him. You got it, right? He's seated at the right hand of the Father. Therefore, we are seated at the right hand of the Father because we're in Him. I know you understand that. It is very basic in Him or in Christ truth. And we need to get a hold of that, that wherever Jesus is, that's where we are. And whatever His relationship is to the Father, that's our relationship. His ability becomes our ability. We can do all things through Christ who strengthens us. Amen. I have over 500 in Him scriptures in my notes. Praise God. And no, I'm not sharing them, not all at once. Give me about 10 years and I'll share every one of them with you. In fact, I've mentioned this before, but my wife and I are working on a manuscript, daily in Christ devotional. We're calling it Every Day in Christ. And the format will be day one, she'll give a in Him scripture and comment about it. Day two, I'll give an in Him scripture and comment. And we'll go through 365 scriptures, one for each day, that tells something of who we are in Christ. This would be a great devotional, a great way for people to learn who they are and to memorize the Word and get their minds renewed with these new creation realities. So be looking for that. I can't promise you exactly when it's going to happen, but it will happen because we are working on it. We're very motivated to do it. However, we've been going through some changes. The winds of change are blowing. And because of that, we've had to kind of prioritize what we're doing. And although that book is a high priority, we've got some other things that we've got to do before we do the book. And there you have it. So let me talk to you about position. A position, according to Merriam-Webster, is the place where someone or something is in relation to other people or things. The place where someone or something should be, or rank. So when we talk about a position in Christ, we're talking about being where He is. And we're also talking about having a certain rank or ranking in Him. And because Jesus is preeminent, that makes you and I preeminent. I know it's kind of hard for religious people to wrap their brains around this stuff, but you're not religious. You're a believer. You are a Bible believer, praise God, a believing believer, I like to say. And so you don't struggle with these new creation realities or these New Testament truth. Praise God. So here's what we're talking about. We have been raised up together positionally with Christ into the heavenlies where He is seated beside the Father. And that puts us far above all principalities and powers. Look at this. Praise the Lord. Colossians 1:16. By Him all things were created that are in heaven and in earth, whether visible or invisible. You know, there are some invisible things. And this is not a spiritual comment I'm getting ready to make, but just a physical comment. You and I see less than 3%, I beg your pardon, 0.038% of the electromagnetic spectrum. In other words, we see less than a millionth of what there is to see in this universe. There are things that are happening beyond our sight, but they're happening. You know, we have some birds out here in a yard, and they see into the infrared further than we see. We can only see so far, and anything above that in the infrared, we can't see it. But it's still there, praise God. We can't see into the infrared or the ultraviolet, but it's still there. We can't see microwaves, but they're still there. We can't see television waves, radio waves, but they're still there. There's a lot of things we can't see. They are invisible to our eye, but that doesn't mean they don't exist. And there are things in this world created by God that we don't have the ability to perceive with our natural eye or with our five senses. I believe it was Arthur Rhodes said, "They who think through their physical senses are totally ignorant of God's spiritual messages." So sight, sound, touch, taste, and hearing are all our five physical senses, but we can perceive things through the Spirit by faith. Faith can see into the realm of the invisible. We walk by faith and not by mere physical sight. So we know that there are angels, right? We may not see them. You don't have to see an angel to believe in angels. The Bible says there are angels. In fact, the Bible has more to say about angels than it does about devils. But if you listen to people talk, they seem to be, a lot of people, not you of course, but a lot of people are more devil conscious than they are angel conscious. But remember, there are more with us than there are with them. In other words, there are more angels than there are devils. So we believe in angels. I believe in angels. I have encountered angels. I have seen angels, not only with the eye of faith, but I've seen them with my eyes as well. So praise God. There are things that are invisible and visible. Praise God. And you and I don't wrestle against flesh and blood, but against principalities and powers. I'm reading from Ephesians 6:12. I don't think I finished Colossians 1:16, but I'll go back to that. I'm jumping around a little, but that's okay. I just want to get through this and get into the meat of my message. So Ephesians 6:12, we wrestle not against flesh and blood, not with people. A lot of people are involved in politics to the point where they're wrestling and they're exasperated by what's going on. But what we have to understand is that the powers that be are ordained of God. So let's don't wrestle with flesh and blood. Let's don't get physically involved with a revolt and revolution and all that kind of stuff. Let's walk by faith and not by sight. Amen? We don't wrestle with flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places or heavenly places. So you and I are raised up into the heavenlies, but we're raised up further than the devils. They occupy a region of the heavenlies, a lower region, but you and I are positioned in a higher region. In fact, Jesus said he's given us authority or a ranking above the authority or the ranking of devils. In fact, they're under our feet. We have the ability to tread on serpents and scorpions. Praise God. So you have to, when you're dealing with devils or thinking about them or talking about them, you always have to do it from a position of strength, from a position of authority. A lot of people are afraid of devils. I'm not afraid of devils. They don't cause my pulse to increase one heartbeat. They don't cause my blood pressure to go up. In fact, Sister Loretta and I were talking about this at breakfast this morning, about having seen into the realm of the spirit. Mm-hmm. I was in Hyderabad, India years ago. I just finished about a 36-hour trip getting there. I laid down on the bed in my hotel. I was traveling by myself, getting ready to do a crusade. I laid down on my bed by myself in a hotel. I laced my fingers behind my head, and I was just lying there. I looked at the wall across the room, and through the wall comes a demon. And he just kind of zooms quietly, didn't make a sound, right up into my face and was staring at me with evil, evil eyes. Just so much hatred and animosity, pure evil. And I looked at this devil, and this devil looked at me, and then it passed out of my vision into the wall behind my head. And as soon as that one disappeared, here came another one, same thing, came right through the wall, right across the room, right up into my face, grimacing, threatening, not with words, but just I could feel the evil of this thing didn't bother me a bit. I laid there on my bed for about an hour, and one devil after the next. It's like every devil in Hyderabad came to visit me and check me out. And I found it kind of entertaining. There wasn't any TV in the room, so I just watched this parade of devils come through my wall and look at me. I suppose it was the discerning of the spirits. You know, I was seeing into the realm of the spirit, but it seemed like they were right there in the room with me. I'm sure they were in another dimension. And after I grew tired of this show, this show they were putting on, I sat on the edge of my bed. I said, okay, that's enough. You've seen me. I've seen you. And I declare that I'm going to have miracles in this crusade. People are going to be saved and healed with and filled with the Spirit. And I plead the blood of Jesus over myself and over everyone in my crusade. And I went to sleep and slept soundly and peacefully. Devils don't bother me. A lot of people are bothered by devils. Well, when you find out who you are in Christ, you won't be bothered anymore. You and I are raised up into the heavenlies above the position of devils. Praise the Lord. So let's go back to Ephesians 6:12. I didn't finish that. We wrestle, I beg your pardon, Colossians 1:16. We finished Ephesians 6:12. Now we're back to Colossians 1:16. I want to finish that. For by him, by God, all things were created that are in heaven and in earth, visible and invisible, whether they be thrones, dominions, principalities, powers, all things were created for him and by him. So we know that there are worldly principalities and powers. There are dictators, there are presidents, there are rulers in the present world, but there is a double kingdom. And in the realm of the spirit, there are principalities and powers and rulers of darkness. Praise God. Yes. Ephesians 2:2 says that the devil himself is the prince of the power of the air or the atmosphere. Now I'm going to share something that I shared maybe once or twice before publicly, and I'm going to share it again, and I believe that we all need to think about this. There are a lot of false prophets in the world. Jesus said, beware of false prophets. That was a warning from Jesus to us. And we should take heed. If Jesus says there are false prophets, then honey, there are false prophets. You can just write that down in your book and believe it. If there are true prophets, there are false prophets. In Matthew 24, Jesus said, many false prophets have come into the world, and they'll deceive many. He didn't say a few false prophets. He said a lot of false prophets. In fact, there are more false prophets than there are true prophets. There are more counterfeit prophets than there are true prophets. Now, here's a better word. When you say false prophet, it kind of gives a connotation of something that's really evil and someone who's purposely trying to deceive, you know, like a witch doctor or charlatan, some chameleon sociopathic prophet, you know, who's out to get you. No, most prophets are sincere, even false prophets, but they're sincerely wrong. I don't doubt their sincerity. They're wanting to prophesy. They're wanting to speak for God. They're wanting to help people. But because they're not tapped into the right source, then they're speaking the wrong things at the wrong time for the wrong reasons. In fact, there was in Acts 16, we read about this damsel that had a spirit of divination. And she was a slave girl, and she made her masters a lot of money because of her divination. You know, there's money in this false prophecy business. There are even psychic hotlines and things like that you can go on and pay a fee to listen to someone tell you a lie. I don't know why anybody would want to do that, but that's the world we live in. And there are people who make money with false prophecies. I know it even happens in the church where there are people that actually, I don't even like to talk about this, but you know, you send $1,000, you're going to get this prophecy. You send $500, you're not going to get the same prophecy as the $1,000 gift and so forth. That stuff is I would never touch that. I would never come near that. I have too much fear of God to ever merchandise the prophetic anointing. I won't do it. If I err, I'm going to err on the side of caution. There are a lot of things that I don't prophesy, I won't say, because I'm not 100% sure. And I told God years ago, I said, listen, if you want me to give a word of knowledge, a word of wisdom, or a prophecy, you've got to make it clear to me. I said, you made me, you know how I think, I'm a little hard-headed, I can be dense at times, and if I'm not sure that you have given me a word, I'm not going to give it, and it's not out of disobedience, it's out of caution, it's out of a sincere desire to be right. I have people all the time, there's not a week that goes by that someone doesn't get a hold of me and ask me, do you have a word for me? And I always say, no, but if I do, I'll contact you. I'm not going to make anything up. There is no blessing in making things up. That's not what I do. I can pray for you. I can give you a word out of the Bible, which is a more sure word of prophecy, but I am not going to play games with the prophetic anointing. However, a lot of people do. Now, getting back to this girl who had a spirit of divination, here's what she said. She prophesied about Paul and Silas, and she said, these men are the servants of the Most High God who have come to show us the way of salvation. Now, what's wrong with that? Was that true? Yes, Paul and Silas were the servants of the Most High God. Praise God. We're talking about being seated in the heavenlies right next to God. So there are devils who are in these lower regions. Satan, who is the demigod of this world, is in the lower regions of the heavenlies, of the spiritual realm, but God is in the highest region of the spiritual realm, and so she called God the Most High God. Well, she was right. He is the Most High God. He's not the low God. He's the high God. He's not the God of the, that operates in the lower realm where the devils operate. He operates in the realm of heaven itself, the highest heaven, the third heaven. Okay, you get that. What else did this girl say that had the spirit of divination? She said, these men have come to show us the way of salvation. So, you know, a novice would listen to that and say, well, this must be a prophetic voice, because this voice is speaking the truth. This voice is saying these men are the servants of God, the Most High God. They've come to show us the way of salvation. Nothing that she said was incorrect or false at this point. But she was wrong. And the source where she got her information was wrong. And many days passed, and she kept doing this, and this surprises me, because, you know, Paul is my hero, and he let many days pass. I don't know how many days is, more than two or three, I'm sure, maybe five, six, seven, or eight. Maybe that's many days. Maybe it's 3 weeks. I have no idea. But after many days, Paul got fed up with it, and he cast the devil out of this girl, and it threw everything into an uproar. These men who were making money because of this girl who had a spirit of divination were upset, and so they conspired to have Paul and Silas arrested because of it. The devils were upset. The whole kingdom of darkness was upset because Paul cast this spirit of divination, this false prophetic spirit, out of this girl. Now then, I'm going to go back to this point, because it's real important. I don't know how many times I've heard people say, well, that guy must be a real prophet because what he said was true and what he said came to pass, or this woman must be a real prophetess because what she said was true. How could they know that? You know, they knew something about me. Well, honey, familiar spirits are familiar with people, and they can communicate the part they're familiar with. They know people's habits. They know people's fears. They know how people respond in given situations because they've been studying people, following people, watching people. And so when a evil spirit, a familiar spirit, communicates to a false prophet, sure, that false prophet will know some things. And the test isn't the fact that what they said was accurate or true. The test is, did it come from God or not? I know people don't get that. I said it, and I can almost feel a vacuum out there. People say, wait, but you know, the thing that this person said to me was right and true. Okay, again, I'm going to go through this very slowly. If the source is wrong, then even though the false prophet is saying the right thing, it's the wrong source and it's going to get the wrong results. It has to be right on every level. The prophet has to be a prophet of God. The prophet has to receive a word from God, the Most High God, and the prophet has to speak that word at the right time for the right reason before that word's going to have the right results. There are conditions. Praise God. I'll get into that a little further if I have time. Timekeeper, how am I doing here?
You have about 6 minutes.
About 6 minutes. Well, I'm going to have to kind of wind things down here a little bit. But let's talk about the third heaven. Praise God. Paul in 2 Corinthians 12:2. Here's another scripture for you. 2 Corinthians 12:2. Said he knew a man in Christ 14 years ago, whether in the body or out of the body, I can't tell. In other words, it was lucid, it was real, it wasn't imaginary. God knows. Such a one was caught up into the third heaven. Third heaven. Now we have three Greek words for heavens. The first heaven is the physical heaven. The stars, the moon, the earth. Praise God. The earth is part of the first heaven because it's made out of star stuff, right? It's made out of dust. It's made out of molecules and atoms. The same thing that stars and asteroids and comets are made out of. Everything in the universe is made out of the same kind of stuff. You know, you can find it on the periodic table. There may be some missing parts to the periodic table, but I'm telling you what, stars and planets are pretty common. And because of the Earth is part of the solar system, part of the Milky Way galaxy, part of the universe, we are part of that first heaven, that lower heaven, the earthy part. God made the sun, the moon, the stars, and the earth at the same time. The second heaven, the atmospheric heaven, is the realm of devils and demons, principalities and powers and wicked spirits. And then the third heaven is the highest heaven. That's the realm of God. So one, the earth. Two, the atmosphere. Three, heaven itself, where God is, where Jesus is, and where you are. Now listen, we have been raised up into the third heaven. People who don't worship God and who don't commune with God, who don't enter into the Holy of Holies with God, who don't get before the mercy seat of God, who don't get into the atmosphere of glory in the Holy of Holies, often operate out of the second heaven, the realm of devils. And because they're not operating from the third heaven, but the highest heaven, then they are susceptible to hearing and receiving messages from devils. You see, a real prophet is going to be in the presence of God. He's going to come into the presence of God by the blood of Jesus. A real prophet is not going to deal with lies. You can't do that in the Holy of Holies. You cannot be in the Holy of Holies and tell lies at the same time. That those lies aren't going to work in the Holy of Holies. If you're in the Holy of Holies, there's such conviction. The awesome presence of God, the goodness of God, the reality of God is going to dominate everything, our thoughts. And Balaam, for example, and the people have the spirit of Balaam who deal in falsehoods and false prophecies and so forth, are not going to be able to operate those lying gifts from the Holy of Holies. So if they want to keep doing what they're going to do, they're going to avoid the Holy of Holies. They're going to avoid getting in the presence of God. They might look holy, they might look spiritual, they might sound spiritual, but they're actually not operating from the third heaven. They're operating from the second heaven. The second heaven are where the clairvoyants are, the psychic mediums are, the diviners are, the soothsayers are, the witch doctors are, all those people who deal in clairvoyance and psychic communication. That's all second heaven stuff. And it's spooky and it's weird, but it happens. And there are people who prophesy in church, not something they heard from the mercy seat, but something they heard in this second realm. Mm. They're saying things from the second realm and not from the third realm. Paul said, I was caught up into the third heaven, and you and I were raised up in Christ Jesus into the third heaven. Why would we want to go to a lower heaven and speak things that are not original with God, whose origin is not with God, is what I'm trying to say. Praise God. Now, why did I go through all this? Why did I talk about all this? Change is coming, and every time there's change, there will be prophetic voices out there talking about that change. I remember just a couple of years ago, this thing about the blood moon was big. Jesus said, you know, if we're not careful, the very elect will be deceived. And some of the biggest names in celebrity Christianity were caught up in this saying, oh yeah, the blood moon, it's going to be a sign of the end times. And they started predicting all these things were going to happen. They should have listened to me. I said, don't worry about it. There's nothing to it. Nothing's going to come of it. It's a non-event. Don't pay attention to it. But, you know, people have their favorite celebrity prophets out there they listen to, and they were led down the primrose path. Mm-hmm. Let me tell you what happens. That causes confusion. It harms people's faith. It makes them question, you know, are they hearing from God and so forth. So we have to be very careful about listening to that kind of stuff. Praise God. Well, we are running out of time, but I don't want to leave you just hanging here. I want to give you something very positive to go with, and that is you don't have to worry about false prophets because you have a direct access to the Holy of Holies. You don't have to worry about spurious prophets and prophecies. You spend time fellowshipping with God, and you recognize a true prophet from a false prophet. You spend time in the Holy of Holies, and you recognize a true prophecy as opposed to a false prophecy. You handle enough real $100 bills, you'll recognize a counterfeit $100 bills when it comes into your hand, and you hang around real prophets. Jesus said, receive a prophet because he really is a prophet, and you'll get the prophet's reward. Do you know what the inverse of that is? If you hang around a prophet who's not really a prophet, you're not going to get the real prophet's reward. The real prophet's reward comes from hanging around, spending time, being in relationship with the real prophet. And that qualifies you to put you in position to get the real prophet's reward. So be careful how you hear. Be careful who you're listening to. He who has ears to hear, let him hear what the Spirit of truth is saying. Praise God. God's got good things planned for you, no matter what the prophets of doom and gloom are saying. God has good things in store for you. You heard it here. Praise God. Listen, I'm going to put up my little screen here for a second and invite you to become my partner. Join in with me. He who receives a prophet because he really is a prophet gets a prophet's reward. I want to speak words of truth into your life. I want to speak words of edification and encouragement in your life. I don't know if you realize it, but from the beginning of this program all the way up to now, I've been prophesying to you. I have been proclaiming by the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, the Word of God. And that's what prophecy is. It's an inspired word from God. And this entire broadcast, I have been giving you an inspired word from God. This is not just something wrote and packaged and recycled. This is a narrow word. The winds of change are blowing. And I want you to be in relationship with me so that when I receive a word from God, I can bless you with that word. Praise God. For less than $1 a day, you can be my partner. I'm not going to ask you for $1,000 so I can give you a $1,000 prophecy. I don't work that way. You should know me well enough to know that I'm going to stick right down the middle with the Word of God every time. Well, are you ready to have communion? We are going to have a deliverance communion.
Praise God. Praise God.
Amen.
Amen.
Years ago, it seemed like every other person had a deliverance ministry. It's funny how things run in cycles, you know. Every other person today has an apostolic ministry, even though, you know, they really may or may not have done apostolic work. Still, there's so many apostles. And before that, the fad was everybody's prophet. And, you know, you keep going back. There was a time when everybody had a deliverance ministry. And they were casting devils out of people and coughing them up into paper sacks and all kinds of nonsense. And Brother Hagin used to say, God deliver us from deliverance ministries. You know, it seemed like the more they talked about devils, the more access devils had. We don't need to brag on the enemy. We need to brag on God. We are more than conquerors through Christ. We don't have to worry. Deliverance for you and me is instant. The moment we believe that we're raised up into the heavenlies, into the third heaven, we're delivered. Praise God. The moment we believe that we are seated in the heavenly places far above principality and power, we are delivered. You don't have to cough up any devil into a paper sack. All you have to do is believe that you are seated in the heavenly places in Christ, far above principalities and powers. One step to deliverance, believe the word. Just like that, you're free. You don't have to go through hours of spitting and choking and thrashing around the floor and having people shake you and pour water on you and pour oil on you and do all that rigmarole. All you need to do is believe that you're a new creature in Christ and believe that you've been raised up into heaven.
You know, Ambassador, I just want to say that that is such a blessing. Excuse me for speaking off camera. But I wanted to get back to that part where you were talking about knowing the truth from the false. And you mentioned just kind of briefly that how people are able to determine a real money from counterfeit money.
Yeah.
The banks train them, from what I read, that the banks train their tellers by having them handle real money, and then occasionally they'll slip a counterfeit in there. And because the weight is different,
yeah.
And you're talking about the presence of God and the glory of God, you know, you can tell the weight, because glory has weight.
Ah, that's a good
Isn't
point.
That good?
That's
yes.
a very good point, yes.
I was
yes.
just thinking about that.
Glory has substance, it has weight. Well, we're going to have communion, and we're going to make this a deliverance communion. And what do you mean by that? Well, we have been raised up above principalities and powers and wicked spirits, the rulers of darkness. We are far above them. They're under our feet.
Praise
now listen, when we have communion, the body and the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ, we are remembering or actually going through the process of recalling what he did for us. He suffered for us. He died for us. But wait, that's just part of it. A lot of people talk about, you know, Jesus went to the cross for you. Absolutely. But he rose from the dead for you. And beyond that, he ascended into heaven for you. I'm crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live, yet not I, but it's Christ that lives in me. And the life that I now live, I live by the faith of the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. Listen, when he was raised up, you were raised up. Praise the Lord. And so we are recognizing the death, resurrection, and ascension of Jesus. Let's talk about the ascension, being raised up into heaven. That's a part of communion.
Yeah.
Was he bodily raised? Yes, he was. People saw him. They touched him. They had. They ate with him. And then after 40 days, he went up into heaven. Caught up in the clouds, and right now he's seated at the Father, and you and I are in him. Now, what did he do when he went into heaven? He went into the Holy of Holies, and he offered up his blood on the mercy seat for an eternal sacrifice for you and me. Praise the Lord. So here we have it. Jesus was raised from the dead, and he ascended into the Holy of Holies. And he took his blood with him, and he put it on the mercy seat. We're getting ready to have third heaven communion right now. Praise the Lord. Father, I thank you that Jesus didn't remain in hell, and he didn't remain on the earth. He ascended into heaven itself. in his death, burial, resurrection, and ascension. And when he was put in the grave, we were figuratively put in the grave. When he rose, we figuratively arose. But when he ascended into heaven, we ascended with him. We are raised up and seated together with him in the heavenlies. And when we partake of this bread, we're recognizing our oneness with Jesus, who's seated at the right hand of the Father in his corporal body. Praise God, his resurrected, glorified body. Right now, we are in Christ, and we're going to take this bread together. I'm going to have to come up with some bread that's easier to chew. Then he took the cup, took his blood into the Holy of Holies, praise God, and he put it on the mercy seat. Where is the mercy seat? The third heaven, the highest heaven, where you and I are seated. The third heaven, the highest heaven, where the devils, way down below us in that lower heaven, that second heaven. You and I don't have anything to do with them. We're far above them. We have a right to come into the presence of God, to the Holy of Holies, by the blood of Jesus. This is the only thing that will get you into the third heaven, the blood of Jesus. Praise God. We need to sing about it, pray about it, talk about it, and as often as we do this, recognize the importance of the blood of Jesus. This is the cup of deliverance. This is the cup of freedom. This is the cup of authority, and let's drink it together in Jesus' name. Oh, the blood of Jesus. Oh, the blood of Jesus. Oh, the blood of Jesus. It washes white as snow. Well, I hope you had a good time. I hope you learned something. And just kind of a little simple review. If you spend time in the third heaven, you'll recognize falsehood and false prophecies and false prophets. Just spending time with God, fellowshipping with Jesus in the third heaven is going to help you spot the truth and also spot errors. Simple, isn't it?
Yes.
So we're in a time of change. Don't be afraid about the wrong voices out there. Don't be afraid about the lying, whatever. You are a child of God, and you're not going to be misled or deceived, not if I have anything to do with it. Praise God in Jesus' name. All right. Well, we love you. Thank you, Sister Loretta, for helping. And thank you, Marsha Murphy, for helping moderate. Thank you, everyone, for your comments. And we're going to be signing off here. I want you to have a good day. It's Sunday for us, so I know a lot of people are headed to church. And we're going to put up one last little screen for you there so that you can get a hold of us if you want to. We love you. Bye. Bye.
Praise God.